Welcome to Rajendra Tandon videos. Today we take up the famous, well-known, often read and cited story of Savitri and Satyavana. The context is the discussion about Draupadi between Yudhishthir and Markandeya. Yudhishthir is saying that, have you ever seen any woman so pious, so virtuous like Draupadi? Markandeya replies, there was a lady, Savitri, who was born to King Ashwapati. She was an epitome of virtue, chastity, and of love for her husband. She was born when Goddess Savitri herself appeared out of a Havan Kund and blessed the king with the birth of a divine child. The daughter, as born to the king, grew up, and as the writer of Mahabharata writes, Ta Sumadhyam Prithushronim Pratimam Kanchanimiv Prapteyam Dev Kanyeti Drishtva Samme Nirejana. Her waist was slim, her hips were broad. She looked as if made out of gold. Everybody believed that it was a Devkanya who had come to earth. She was named Savitri. As she grew up, the king worried about her marriage because it was believed that if the daughter attains the marriage age and the father doesn't marry her, then he has to be deplored. He is not following a dharma. Likewise, if a husband does not have sex with his wife, he too has to be condemned. A son who does not take care of his widowed mother, he has been placed in the same category by the writers of Mahabharata. Savitri's father asked her to find out a suitable match for herself because she might not agree to what he could suggest. She went away into the nearby forest. She visited several cities, several towns, several kingdoms. Till she stumbled upon King Dhumatsen of Shalvades, who was blind and whose kingdom had been taken away by hostile neighbors. He had a son, at that time young. The king went into a forest with his wife and this young son. The name of the son was Satyavana, and Savitri liked him, although they were living in penury in a forest. She told her father that she had found a suitable boy for her to marry. The king was worried. Was this devoted son of a demoted king, of a blind king, glorious, wise, and valorous? Did he have the virtue of pardoning others for their mistakes? He consulted Narad about it. The latter replied, "This young prince, although without a kingdom, is glorious like the sun, is wise like Brihaspati, he is brave like Indra, and he is the epitome of the virtue of pardon like the earth." Narad was asked again, "Is Satyavan given to charity? Is he handsome? Is he generous? Does he look nice?" Narad replied, "Satyavan gives charity according to his means. He is like Rantidev. He is virtuous and follows his dharma and is truthful like Shivi. He is generous like Yayati. He looks good like the Chandrama. He is so handsome that even Ashwini Kumars cannot compete. He has conquered his senses. He is soft in speech, sweet in voice and words. He is a warrior and he is friendly to all." He is not arrogant. He lives a life of simplicity. However, Narad said, "There is a problem. This young prince would die within 1 year from today. So advise Savitri to marry somebody else." However, Savitri had decided to marry Satyavan alone. And now starts one of the finest stories ever written about a virtuous woman overcoming the death, destined death of her husband. Savitri, accompanied by her father, went into the forest and found the blind king sitting under a tree on a mat made of kusha grass. They were welcomed, as was customary, with arghya, a seat, and asking about their welfare. In due course, they said they had come because Savitri wanted to marry Satyavan. Dumutsen, the father of the future bridegroom, said, "Look, we are paupers. Why should this king's daughter marry my son? And we are living in forest. She may not be able to stand the difficulties of life in this jungle." Savitri's father replied, "Joy as well as sorrow are impermanent. They come and go. Me and my daughter know about this. So don't disappoint me. Please allow us to marry my daughter to your son. Accept her as your daughter-in-law." The marriage took place. Savitri took off all the ornaments which she was putting on, put on simple clothes to live in the jungle, and with her service with her qualities. Savitri won the hearts of Satyavan's parents as well as of Satyavan. Her words were melodious. She was dexterous in whatever she did. She was of a peaceful mien and of a calm mind. But she was also worried because the destined time for Satyavan's death was arriving near and near. On the appointed day, they got up early. Satyavan went into the jungle with Savitri. She knew what would happen. She was ready for it. She had been fasting in anticipation of this event. In the jungle, Satyavan had a severe headache and he became unconscious. At that time, Savitri noticed Yama coming towards Satyavan. He was a divine person, putting on red clothes, a crown. He looked glorious like the sun, although he was dark of complexion. Savitri was sitting with Satyavan's head in her lap. Satyavan was already unconscious. She asked Yama, "Who are you? Why do you come here? What do you want?" Yama replied, "O pious woman, know me as Yamaraj. Your husband's time on this earth is over and I shall take him to my loka, to my world." He is so truthful, he is so religious, he has got so many virtues that my messengers could not come and take him away, so I have come personally. I would take out his life spirit and carry it with me. And he did it. Savitri said, "No, I would also go wherever he has to go. This is my Sanatana Dharma." Yama said, "No, you can't come. You better go and cremate him." Savitri said, "I have to make some issues, raise some issues with you. I want to ask you a few questions for enlightenment." "We have become friends. We are talking to each other. Please listen to me." Those who have not controlled their senses cannot stay on in a forest. Only those who have controlled their senses, who have conquered them, are able to live in a forest. Jitendriya purush hi yeh sab kuch karne mein samarth hain. Van mein rehkar dharma palan, guru kul vas, kasht sahan roop tapasya kar sakte hain. Yamaraj said, "Look, you have delighted me with your question. You ask me for a boon." She said, "Grant me a boon that my father-in-law gets his eyesight back and that he becomes a warrior again and glorious like Agni and Surya." Yama granted this request. But Savitri was not to keep quiet. She said, One should always stay with the sadhus, with people who are truthful, whose conduct is good. Yama said, look, you have said, made another statement which is wise. I'll grant you another boon. She said, restore the kingdom of my father-in-law and give him strength not to give up his dharma at any time. This is my second boon. Please grant it. Yama agreed. Now Savitri said, I want to ask for something else. The qualities of a sadhu purush in Sanatana Dharma include that he should not be inimical to anyone in his thought, in his speech, in his actions. In this world, people have very short lives, so they must inculcate these virtues. Yamaraj said, like water to a thirsty person, your thoughts and ideas have given me relief. You ask for another boon. Savitri said, my father does not have any children beyond me. Please bless him with more progeny. Now, Yamaraj said, granted. Now you go back. Savitri said, I am very near my husband, although he is dead. I'll go back. Don't worry. But I want to say something else. You are the son of the Surya. You are called Vaivaswat, therefore. You follow your dharma. Therefore, you are called Dharmaraj. A human being trusts the saints more than himself. It is goodwill which makes people friendly and believe in each other. The saints have this goodwill towards others. That is why people believe in them. Yamaraj said, you ask me for a fourth boon. You have stated some eternal truths. Savitri said, grant me, O Yamaraj, that me and Satyavan have 100 sons. Yamaraj said, granted, this boon too is granted. The fifth statement which Savitri made at this point of time was that people who can be called better than others on this earth follow truth. It is they who support the present, the future, and the past. They are never disappointed. Anyone who follows truth would be successful. Here too, Dharmaraj said, you ask me for another boon. She said, okay, grant me a boon. You said I'll have 100 children. How can I have 100 children without my husband? Dharmaraj, here appearing as Yamaraj, was defeated in argument. Savitri said, if there is happiness without my husband, I don't want it. I don't want money, but I want his life. Yamaraj said, O noble woman, I release your husband. You have satisfied me with your understanding of truth, of dharma. Satyavan is now without any sickness. He will come alive immediately, and you would have 100 children by cohabiting with him. This is how the story ends. It's a very interesting story. In this, so many virtuous issues have been explained. Thank you for listening to me.